Hey guys, it's Nicole, and this is going to be a really quick video on how to read your nursing textbook. As I mentioned earlier, you should definitely go over those kind of six factors that I brought up before, but I wanted to give an example of how I find the six factors in a textbook. I get tons of messages from you guys regarding how lame your textbook is, and trust me, I've been there, and even my students complain, so I helped a couple of them out. And they found my advice helpful, and I've even used it myself. As a new professor, I was given a curriculum on content that I hadn't studied for in years. I took the NCLEX, I remember, so I had to really kind of sit down, crack the textbook open, and create my PowerPoint presentations. That required me to sit down and read for hours and hours and hours. And I started to find out that the textbook was going over all this stuff that really didn't matter. I was trying to get to the gyms, but I didn't really know how to get there. So I found this system using my six factors, but I wanted to show you how this works in real time and in real life. So let's go over them together. Each course and each class is different, but this has worked for many students and myself. If you have a different situation or setting or program, please put it below. I love when you guys share and give advice to each other because I even use it myself. But let's begin. The very first section is going to be on sinus bradycardia. If you look on this page here, the very first thing that I would focus on are the causes of sinus bradycardia. Everything else is great, but when it comes to EKGs, usually you're going to be asked about a cause. A patient had a high K, or a patient is an athlete, they tend to give you a kind of scenario that would lead you to a particular disease process. And with bradycardia, it tends to be caused by vagal stimulation and a lot of cardiac medication. So usually you get, a patient takes metoprolol at home and their heart rate is 40, what would you expect to see on the EKG? I would ask your professor if he or she are going to put strips on your exam. Most programs do, and that's why that middle section is there to give you your kind of EKG details as far as your PRI and your QRS. Again, in that first paragraph, I would hit the first three sentences and move on. You don't necessarily have to know every cause, but the gist is that four causes are the main reason why sinus bradycardia exists. The other ones are great to know, but you're not expected to know all 38 of them. Again, if you're going to have EKG strips, please know that middle. And that bottom paragraph really goes into vagal stimulation, which is a key classic item of sinus bradycardia. Must you know it? No, but it's going to really help you on some questions. So again, when you have a paragraph that you're unsure about whether to dive into or not, at least read the first two sentences. And then determine if you really want to go into it that deep. But the first three sentences mention vagal stimulation. I would leave it at that, grasp that concept and move on. The other sentences mention ST elevation changes, PVCs, that's all fluff. To me, that goes into a little too much detail. As a nursing student, I want to know what, where, and why, and those things kind of go beyond that. So that bottom paragraph, I would definitely skim and not necessarily focus on because it's not really telling me anything. It's just going deeper into kind of the EKG readings. If your professor wants you to know that, that's one thing, but most of, in my opinion, us do not, don't. I don't need you to know the ST intervals and things like that with sinus bradycardia. I want you to know what's going to kill them, what the intervention, and what you're going to see. So again, your book is required to give you a full, detailed, extensive layout. But as a student, again, try to find those gems where you can and skip the fluff. The next page is crucial because it's medical management. Everyone knows they love knowing drugs. They love telling me drugs, but what are you looking for before you get to the drugs? In this patient presentation with a symptomatic bradycardia, you're looking for changing mental status, chest pain, and hypotension. What is this patient going to look like? If you can close your eyes and visualize what your patient should look like, you're halfway there. Then you get to the meds. Once you visualize the problem and you assess them, then you get to the meds. But most questions want to make sure you're properly identifying the disease process and you're assessing your patient. Yes, atropine is awesome. It's great. But what should you do before you give a drug? Assess your patient. What do you want to look for? If you have chest discomfort, what would you be treating? If you have hypotension, what would be the interventions for that? So don't necessarily just write medical treatment, atropine, and move on, because there's other dynamics that you haven't really unpacked. With sinus bradycardia, it says it's based on the cause and the symptoms. So you don't just treat every clinical presentation of sinus bradycardia. Read those first two sentences of that paragraph. They are gems. Again, usually the middle's fluff, but those first two or three sentences, they're always golden, baby. So please, please, please read those. Your textbook, again, kind of breaks down what an EKG reading is. If you must know that, great. If not, I would skip it. Most professors will tell you, not on the test, not on the test, on the test, and go from there. I get that you don't have time to read everything, but again, if you skim through everything, it's not going to stick. But if you read those first two or three sentences, that's where that juice is. So definitely, definitely do that. That first kind of section was for sinus bradycardia. That was a very easy section. I think it was one or two pages in my textbook. The next example is PUD, and it's a little more convoluted and involved, and I'll tell you what to skip and what to read. So let's begin. In PUD, the pathophysiology section is very, very long. Here, I would focus on the first, what, 3 to 4 sentences and skip the rest. You should focus on the mucosal damage and exposure. The next paragraph mentions the drugs that cause PUD, which is a gem. I would definitely focus on that. This DES thing, again, this is a subspecialty of PUD. I would skip that entire section. Unless my professor said focus on the DES and the stress ulcers, I would not read those. The pathophysiology I would focus on in this section, again, is those first 3 to 4 sentences and what drugs would cause PUD. All the other stuff is really great to know if you have the time, but if you are down and dirty, you have to go to work, or you have to babysit, or you have personal plans or other kind of arrangements in place, focus on what's important. This DES and this stress ulcer and fiber optic endoscopy, that is really great to know. But again, if you use your 6 factors, those are further down the road. The next slide, clinical manifestations, which again, 6 factors from the last video, that signs and symptoms and clinical presentation. And again, you focus on the general thing. The second paragraph says, as a rule, a patient with an ulcer will complain of this, this, and this. Classic signs and symptoms. This paragraph goes into non-specific symptoms. I would not get into anything that has the word non-specific in it, because everything non-specific. Focus on classic signs and symptoms, or typical presentation is what you're going to focus on. The clinical manifestation section is 4 paragraphs long. Again, read those first 1 to 3 sentences, and if you find value in that, keep moving. But you going over statistical information and etiology, I don't think most places test on that. I mean, it's great to know if it affects African Americans more. That's great, but usually, again, you're getting tested on what your patient looks like, what you're doing, and the educational and pharmacology aspects of it. Etiology and ethnic background information is great, but again, that's usually not what you're tested on, in my personal opinion. After that, you have assessments and diagnostics. You have to know how this is diagnosed. As a nurse, you get a patient with PUD, what would be the diagnostic testing you will go down for? And if you look, it says upper endoscopy. That's it. Obviously, when you have disease processes, they could be diagnosed with 9 different tests, but look for the word preferred or golden or standard. That's gonna always save you from reading all these paragraphs and all this other stuff. And again, when it comes to medical management, you want to always assess before you do anything, but know your meds. Know your meds all day, every day, and know the generic name. The brand names are great, but they're always all over the place. Focus on the generic names. Any sort of chart like the one you see here, I would focus on. But again, focus on the generic ending. That's going to really save you. And most resources lack nursing considerations, meaning, are you going to give this medication with food? What are the adverse effects to look for? I wouldn't just write down medications when it comes to a study guide when in relation to medications. If you're giving a med, you should know what's going to happen with this med. Is this drug going to heal this ulcer, or is this drug for an infectious process? Because they all do different things. And that's where, you know, some gaps happen. Some students don't get questions wrong because they don't know the content. They just didn't expand enough in their reading of the textbook. So that's where those gems come in. And again, when it comes to nursing considerations, please, please, please know them. A big section a lot of students miss is education, and it's easy peasy. But a lot of people don't really read this section. When it comes to discharge care, smoking is going to exacerbate PUD. You should then educate on smoking cessation. When it comes to dietary considerations, you're going to be educating on that. Again, close your eyes, visualize this patient, and when you walk with your discharge paperwork, what would be the important points, the key points to hit upon discharge? And it would be those two topics. That's it. We just skimmed 3 to 4 pages and we talked this out together and you got your 6 factors. Reading a textbook, I know when you sit down and look at it with the tiny font, it's overwhelming, but I promise you it's not. Keep those 6 factors in your mind, close your eyes, visualize your patient, and you're going to be just fine. I'll put a pop-up somewhere of the 6 factors, but those are the things that I focus on when I read the textbook for my lectures. Again, I might be a critical care nurse, but I don't know everything. When I get my curriculums, I have to sit down and read just like you do, because I'm getting paid for this and you're paying for this, so I want you to get your money's worth. I don't want to just breeze over the topics. I want you to get this juice out of this content. So questions or comments, put them below. Thanks for watching, guys. Good luck and have a happy holiday. Bye.